Thank you. I feel very privileged to be here. I feel very privileged to be here. I was here 10 years ago. I even sat in my little bedroom and watched the proceedings in New Brunswick Parliament when you had Children Home Day declared. It was a great privilege to be able to do that. And thank you for allowing me to talk to you. Yes, the people in the UK really don't know much about the British home children. As I said, I went to a conference, I found out about them, I was so intrigued by what had happened, so ashamed that I didn't know about it, that I've been reading about it, I've been searching about it ever since. One of the people invited me to go to their meetings to tell them about the home children. When I get to the end, my first question is, well, did you know anything about this? And the answer is no. Maybe one person puts their hand up, maybe two, but that's it, and they have no real knowledge or understanding. I also find that I have to tell them quite a bit about Bristol in Victorian times, because the Bristol home children were sent out earlier than the middle more children. From about 1868 to, I think, the last voyage was about 1912. A little bit difficult because records aren't always there, as you know. We lost a lot of our records in 1940 in an air raid, which makes things very difficult. One of the first things I have to do to tell people, and I just say that if you can see this, for this young lady, and it's not showing up that, this young lady in the middle was 3 years old when she was picked up on the streets of Bristol. And while she looked rather sweet now, she would have been extremely smelly, covered in sores, eyes running, red, and usually infections of the ears as well. That's the sort of problem that we had on the streets of Bristol at that time. It was, and they had to tell Bristol people about their own city in Victorian times. Doesn't show up very much, but we had a port right in the middle of the city, and surrounding that were factories and furnaces, pushing smoke and smuts into the air. Streets were narrow and twisting. Courts where two families might be living in one room. I can't actually fully appreciate what it was like to be so poor. I just can't. I think that's hard. When your priority is food, and you sell everything for food, and I have to get that over to people in the UK. You sell your furniture, you sell your clothes, and yes, we really did have children on the streets of Bristol, dressed in rags, tied around with string, we really did. If you lost your man, there was no widow's pension. There was no birth control, no minimum wage. Life was very tough in those times. So this photograph, if you can see it, hopefully, 1886, children on the streets. There are three of them there. You can't see that young man or lad or girl, I don't know. But those were the children that people gathered up and sent to Canada. Because on the streets of our city, you will see these children huddled in doorways to get out of the wind. They lived with beggars, gangs of children. Lived by scavenging, and they lived like rats, scavenging for what they needed. Children crippled with rickets, begging in the streets, getting in the way of people going about their purposes. And I can promise you, in my city, tiny girl prostitutes stood on the corner of the street. It was a huge problem. Much more, perhaps, than we fully understand. Now, the government thought that they had a solution to deal with the poor of the city, on the poor of the whole of UK. They grouped villages in 30 or 40 villages. They called it a union, and they built a workhouse right in the middle. Then they thought that was going to be the answer to these people on the streets. So we had Bristol Workhouse in this, Bristol Workhouse in this lovely old building. I'm afraid it was destroyed in the war by one of Hitler's bombs. And this was on the edge of the city. And it was from this workhouse that children were first sent over here to Canada. And I have to say, before I talk about that, not the workhouses, nor all the voluntary efforts were equal to the scale of the problem. It was a massive problem. In 1850, the government changed the rules. Now, boards of guardians who ran these workhouses were allowed to send children away without family or without friends. And I have to now say that there was a belief, strong belief in Britain at that time, that children would have a better chance of life, better life in Canada. And this was the feeling of many of the people who sent children away. So Bristol Board of Guardians were visited by someone called Maria Rye, and I hope you've heard of Maria Rye and Annie McPherson. They sent letters, they visited the Board of Guardians, they persuaded them to send children, and took them to her home at Niagara-on-the-Lake. She liked to take girls, she got on better with girls. Annie McPherson took boys, she preferred the boys, and she took them to her home in Belleville. The home was called Marchland, and she took them there. A little bit later on, a man called Mark Whitworth took children. Now, he was the owner of the Great Western Steamship Company, and I always felt that he had an eye to sailing his ships when they brought them come over to this country. The Bristol Board of Guardians sent children from about 1869 to about 1874. And then they suddenly woke up to the fact they hadn't heard about the children. Well, where had they gone? Were they alright? Were they in a good place? And everybody, they were the only Board of Guardians, and everything slowed down. And it stopped then, so then it came to a pause. And then you've got Patrick Doyle, who came over here and did some investigation into emigration, what it was like. Now, when Marion gave me a list of Bristol children who had joined the army, I was really delighted to see that the vast majority of Bristol children came from the Bristol workhouse. And that gave me a better feeling about the workhouse. Then in 1880, I don't know if you've heard of Annie McPherson, but she opened a home in Bristol. It was called the Canadian Home for Little Girls. I believe you may, the Bristol people know nothing about this until I start telling them. There is a group of boys. The home was started up for little girls. They get a group of girls in. And this was the first knowledge that we have of girls actually being trained to be servants. They were taught to make beds, they were taught to cook, to do the laundry, and then they all gathered together and sent out here to Canada. And then the ladies who, and it was ladies, England ladies are daughters or wives of professional men. Those are ladies. I don't know if you knew that. I didn't. And they discovered that these girls had little brothers, so they decided to call in the boys into the home as well. They sent the boys out to Canada when they were eight. They wouldn't keep boys over the age of eight. I think that three-letter word that begins with S worried them a little bit. But there's the boys who were sent out. Now, to me, they look a lot younger than eight, but they were all ready to go come out here
of their little sailor suit song, which is not very appropriate, is it? This home was used by the Board of Guardians to train children much later, and there were no free runs on this home. The Board of Guardians actually had to pay for the children who went there. But I also need to talk a little bit about children breaking the law, because in Victorian times this was taken very seriously. The Victorians had this belief that unless you were very harsh with children, strong with children, that was the only way to teach them to be good. So discipline was very strict. Punishment was harsh. You had beatings, floggings. Children might be put in a single cell, although the light was kept on. They were put in a single cell for maybe 48 hours. They were put on bread and water. Very harsh punishments. Because the Victorians thought it would teach them to be good, they had to think about it. So children were sent to jail. And you can see this young man, he had stolen 4 loaves of bread and he was sent to jail. There was a young man at Bristol, Henry Turner. He was 12. He was sent. He was transported for 7 years. He'd stolen a pair of shoes. So conditions were really harsh. It was important. A strong group of people started to work about not sending children to prison, but sending them to a reformatory, a school for children who'd been found guilty of crimes. And just to say that, this was the boys. That's better. I can't read what I got right. That's brilliant. That's brilliant. Thank you. Kingswood Reformatory for boys. Now, they won't let us see the records. I cannot see the records. But I do know that boys were sent to the farms in Canada from this reformatory. And then, because I really need to tell you about this, because I really think the story about this reformatory for girls called Red Lodge was set up by a woman called Mary Carpenter. Now, she had a brother who lived in Montreal, and what she did was to, he'd found places for the girls, she sent the girls out to Montreal, the girls wrote home is Red Lodge, the matron wrote letters back to them, the letters exist, and we can read that they married, that they have children, and one of the things, just to repeat one letter, was the matron writes to one of the girls and says, could you please go and find Minnie? I haven't heard from Minnie for a long time. I want to know if she's all right. Some caring about what happened to the children when they got out there. That's quite unusual, actually. But you see, although we have now these institutions, the workhouses were very, very full. And there was still a huge problem of all these children on the streets. Now the children here, these children, are standing in the streets outside a beer house where presumably their family, mum, dad, are in there drinking. You would probably, well, I think I know what you think about that. But the Victorians would be a lot harsher about what they would say. The parents inside that workhouse are wicked parents. They are disgraceful parents. They're evil parents. And the children should be taken away. They're not fit to look after those children. This was the feel at that time. They, the parents, the family, are not respectable. And I honestly believe that the Victorians made that word up because they used it all the time. So, links between child and home should be ruthlessly cut off. And now, for the first time, allowed to intervene in the interests of the child. So the idea of an industrial school came about at this time. So here you have police and gentlemen of the city were given the power to pick the children up from the streets, to take them to the magistrate, who would charge them, perhaps being without proper guardianship, maybe being without a home, and they would be sent to an industrial school until they were 16. And we had three industrial schools for boys and three for girls in Bristol. They were schools for the neglected, the orphaned, and the abandoned children. They were lodged, clothed, fed, and taught. They were to equip children for employment rather than academic skills. So they did a lot of industrial training. For example, the boys did tailoring, shoemaking, fishermen's nets that they made, chopped up firewood, bundled it to sell, made their own bread, made their own clothes. They were being taught, and there that is a doll dressed in the uniform down there at the bottom of the page. I come across many descriptions of children, and I want to read you one. Just before tea time, Michael called at Parkrow Industrial School. That's there. He asked for Mr. Lantern, who was the superintendent. Sad he was in a sack fight. Filthy rags pinned around him for clothes, face and hands, very dirty, no shoes to his feet. He had had nothing to eat since the morning before, when a man had given him a new penny loaf. He had three brass buttons for currency. You could get money for brass. And he would give them to Mr. Lansdowne if he would let him come in to stay with his two brothers who were already in the school. And then here's the shocking bit. His father had killed his mother. The police had taken him away to jail, and did Mr. Lansdowne think he would ride all the way? And of course, Mr. Lansdowne took him to the magistrate. The magistrate did all the necessary things, and he was taken into the school. We come across stories like that are quite shocking. This was Clifton School for Boys, a big school. And I'm very surprised. Along one day came a Reverend Shipley, who said, "I will take your boys to Canada." And he then, they didn't know who he was, they allowed this man to take the boys to Canada. He took some to Quebec, and I felt really sorry for those boys because French, they didn't know how to speak French. In Park Row, it was slightly better, I think. One of the old boys, one of the first to go out, was called Edward Waters, and he found a farm in New Glasgow and did very well. So he took on to boys, and there was the Reverend George Rogers, who moved from Bristol to Springfield in Carr's County, and he took a lot of boys with him. And also this man, Mark Whitwell, he took a lot of boys. So the boys went to lots of different places in Canada. Very easy to lose who they were and what they did. We have a training ship, and on there was a school. And these were boys from the streets went on the school. Now they were supposed to go in the Navy, but if you lived on the streets, you're not very strong, you're not very big, and you don't have good teeth. And the Navy wanted boys that were fit and with good teeth. So a lot of the boys from this ship came out to Canada, and they came out with this same Reverend Shipley. And of course we have girls' schools. Can you guess the industrial work that the schools did, the girls did? Nothing interesting like the boys. It was just laundry. That was their industrial work. But here, at this school, we've got some really good indications of how the Victorians looked at these children. And this word respectable comes up again. two girls going to be sent to Canada. One girl can go home and say goodbye to her mother, because her mother is a respectable woman. The other girl was not allowed. Two girls going together, and it made that difference. Then there was Mrs. Knight. Mrs. Knight came in, she'd had some alcohol. It was to give her Dutch courage, I think. And she shouted at the matron, she said, "You are not to send my Margaret to Canada. You are not to send her." And I sat there reading it, and I went, silly woman, because she showed herself to be not respectable. 2 weeks later, the girls in that school are all sewing clothes for Margaret to go to Canada. You see how they judged people, and the judgments were there all the time. And just a simple picture to show it's the philosophy. This school, industrial school, there's the boy, he's taken in on the left, he's taken in, he has his clothes taken away, his hair washed, his hair cut, he can bring nothing with him, everything must be left behind, because what they're going to do with these boys is they're going to make them into honest and industrious men of society and prepare them for another and a better world. They're not allowed to go home at all, but parents can visit once a month. But then I looked at the girls' school, and quite honestly, there were 58 girls in the school, and only 15 were visited in 1 year. The next year there were 52 girls, and only 11 were visited. So it tells you a little about the situation in these schools. I had to take the photographs I can find, and this was a boy going onto that ship from Liverpool, and there he is when they finish with him. You know, this is what we're going to do for these children. As you know, parents have to give permission. So they put notices in the newspaper, they put notices on the lampposts. What happened if parents can't read? You know, children were sent without that knowledge. And they had to go before the justice to say that they knew what was going to happen to them and they understood. Well, if you're 6, how do you understand? If you're 10, even 15, how do you really understand? So I would like to just tell you about 3 children who are going to be sent on what happened to them. Back in Bristol. There were 2 girls. They'd been in a workhouse for 2 years. Obviously, the mother couldn't look after them. She gave permission for the two daughters to be sent to Canada. I think she was probably pressurised. And I thought, how would I deal with that? My 2 daughters sent to Canada knowing I would never see them again. How would I deal with it? And I followed that mother on. The next year she was still in the workhouse. And the year after that she was in the lunatic asylum. Are you surprised? And then I found this in the records. This is Bristol Jail. Maria Rye is in Bristol Jail. And she's given permission to... Maria Stacey is in Bristol Jail. She's given permission for Louisa and Emily, her 2 girls, to go to Canada with Maria Rye. I found out she'd been stealing. She had stolen a joint of meat from a meat safe and a kitchen back door. Now you have to ask yourself, why does she steal meat? But she was in jail 3 or 4 times, and there was another little girl who was sent. So another example. But then I'll finish with a story about John Walcott. John Walcott was a 12-year-old boy. His father had died, his mother was ill, Mrs. Walcott not well at all. John went in the workhouse. Mrs. Walcott went into hospital, she got better, she came out of hospital, and she disappeared. Well, she didn't send for John, let's put it that way. So the guardians sent the relieving officer to find her. He was a bit like a wandering social worker. And he found her, and he took John Walcott back to his mother. But John Walcott didn't want to go back to his mother, so he ran away. And he ran away back to the workhouse. And the guardians of the workhouse were busy getting a group of boys together to go out to Canada, and John Walcott joined them. When Mrs. Walcott found out, she was furious, and she went to the weekly meeting of the Board of Guardians, and this is in the newspaper. And she was very angry, and she said to them, "You must get him back. I told you, you were not to send him to Canada. You sent him without my permission." And the guardians didn't seem to take much notice of it, to be honest. Then the next meeting, she came back with the local magistrate. Now, he does have quite a bit of clout, quite a bit of power. And he told the governor, saying, the guardians, they must get John Walcott back. And he called the inspectors in to inspect the guardians, which happened quite a lot. However, no sign of John Walcott coming back. So Mrs. Walcott did an unusual thing for women at that time, who had no power at all, no status at that time. She went to the county court and got out a writ of habeas corpus, which you normally get when you want to have a dead body returned to you. And she served that writ upon the Board of Guardians, and the Board of Guardians couldn't give them the body of John Walcott because they'd given it to Annie McPherson. And Annie McPherson had given the body of John Walcott to a man called Mr. McKay, a farmer in New Brunswick. So you can't serve a writ of habeas corpus on another country. And so she didn't get John Walcott back. I have this sneaking feeling that John Walcott wanted to go. And I would love to find a descendant of John Walcott and find out the truth, what really happened. And that's the state of play in Bristol at the time, as you can see, quite different from the Middlemore, where they all came from different institutions, and the people who ran that institutions all thought really strongly that life in Canada would be better for these children, away from their parents and their unworthy families. So, a lot to think about. Thank you for listening to